So, welcome everybody. The room is nearly packed. That's perfect. Nice to have you here. One of the first breakout sessions after lunch. A lot of people means a lot of expectations. I hope we can cover most of them as we're trying to share some insights with you on Audi's journey to build an enterprise big data platform. But before we start with the details on that, I first give you some background information, just a few slides about the company and about ourselves. Who are we? We're from the Audi Group. Audi Group consists of four major brands, three of them I guess most of you know. This is Audi itself, Lamborghini, and Ducati. And we have also Ital Design Giugiaro, which is a company that focuses on design of automobiles, but also any other kind of vehicles for transportation purposes. Just short introduction about Audi's strategy for 2025. Yes, in the heart there is still Vorsprung is our promise. Yeah, we want to inspire with premium mobility services and of course premium cars we develop, build and sell worldwide. Yeah, this major goal is covered by three other big topics. One of them is sustainability. Yes, we want to stand for sustainable products through the whole life cycle or whole value chain. Urbanization is a big topic, I guess not only for automobile manufacturers. Yeah, we work with big cities worldwide to build concepts for city-friendly mobile services and mobility. And last but not least, important topic for us, digitalization. We are digitalizing our core processes and build an integration platform for mobility services and as well add data-driven services to our core business.
Hello from my side. I work for Audi Business Innovation. We are a subsidiary of Audi based in Munich. We have three different fields where we work. The first is we develop and also operate Audi mobility solutions. Maybe you have heard already about Audi On Demand, which is a product that's already available in a couple of places worldwide. Audi Balance Technologies is mainly about e-gas, so it's not that customer-based, customer-related. And finally, as Audi Customer IT Solutions, the department I work for, we do different IT projects for Audi mainly, or exclusively for Audi. And among that, for instance, we do big data projects like building this big data platform with Matthias and his team. My name is Carsten. I work for Audi for 3 years now. I do Hadoop for already for a couple of years, have a solid background in data warehousing as well. And as I said, I help Matthias building up this enterprise big data platform. But also in another role, I had one of the first applications that went live end of last year on this platform to use this platform. So I know this platform from both perspectives.
Okay, and my name is Matthias. I'm an architect at the Competence Center for Big Data and Business Intelligence at Audi. I'm responsible for the overall architecture for all shared services we provide for the Audi Group. And I also have more than 10 years experience in classical business intelligence and warehousing, enhanced with some big data experience during the last few years. So, where did we start? 2 years ago, we, as a competence center of big data BI, already provided classical business intelligence capabilities for the whole group. And if you see here a kind of capability map with the core capabilities here in the middle and the supporting capabilities in the right and the left. And we did that for programs for the whole group, for smaller projects, as well as for a few data scientists we had in the past. And as we are a multi-tenant and corporate environment, we did that for all data domains you see here. Yeah, and then things started to change, mainly driven from our production quality as well as car data domain. And what does car data in this context mean is that we collect signals from the control units that are built in the car and send that out over the air. So that all those requirements from car data as well as from the production facilities to be able to work on the signal streams that come out from production robots or machines, we needed to add some capabilities to our existing capability map. So we had to think about cloud computing. Yeah. One major requirement we then had was stream processing, as well as for signals that comes from the production facilities, as well as signals we want to ingest from the cars. Yeah, we needed to think about new data stores. So we needed to add HDFS for storing this big amount of data that occurs. And we had to add machine learning capabilities as well to get the right usage out of this data. So we started with a small cluster by the end of in the year 2015. We decided to start with an appliance, not to investigate in how to build up the system and run the system. The goal was really to see if this new technologies fulfill the business requirements we had. So we decided to start with a small Hortonworks data platform cluster that has 4 nodes, 96 cores, and 160 terabyte of raw capacity. And we started with two proof of concept. One proof of concept was from the production facilities, is about screwdrivers. So we wanted to see if the process of screwing within the production facilities is working well, or if we can predict any problems in the maintenance process up front. And another thing was to see, can we, from the signals we collect out of the car, can we see how our product is really used? Because in the past, we made the handover to the customer, and if a customer really uses a drive select button or he opens a window, we'd had no clue, we had no idea about how is the car really used. So we tried to have a built-in data collector in the car who was sending anonymized data from a management fleet to see if all those data pipelines works as expected. So.
Okay, and when you build a new platform, bring new technologies like Hadoop into an existing enterprise environment, you have a few challenges. The projects are pressing for functionality. They want to use the platform, which is good. On the other side, you have to integrate into the existing business systems. You have a lot of security requirements that are taken very seriously. So I always had a choice to make, and that was an enterprise integration versus beta delivery. And so we started with a step-by-step plan, not with a big goal like designing the platform for 2 years and then delivering to the customers. We had the appliance already there in the middle of our network, where all the office clients are, where all the laptops clients are, so it was not a very good starting point. And then we improved the situation step by step. I think I need the remote.
Thank you.
Okay, let's look where we started. The cluster was just located in our office network. The user management in this appliance was done locally, so there was nothing like an LDAP. And for access control, we decided to use ACLs, access control lists, because it looked very like a flexible solution for us. And you see these errors at the right, they'll make sense later. Then we started with basic security. As the cluster was open to the complete Audi network, which is not a very good option for a Hadoop cluster, as you may know, we use IP tables on the cluster to protect it from a network perspective. That's something usually you don't do. When you read the manual, there's written disable IP tables when you run Hadoop. But as this was an appliance, we had two different network cards on each machine, the internal network used by the cluster, the external used to connect to the cluster. So we just blocked down the external access, and it worked quite well. for the users was a little bit difficult because if they wanted to access some web UI or connect the local Taboo client to Hive, they had always had to open an SSH tunnel. Then our first step towards enterprise integration, of course, we want to integrate with enterprise LDAP to have that the user can use the same credentials everywhere. And we started integrating LDAP with Hive. But only for a very brief moment, because a little bit later, we switched over to Nox to, I don't know if you're familiar with Nox, it's a kind of security gateway that allows you to access certain services of the cluster over HTTP. Like Hive, for instance, but also WebHDFS and a few others. And we thought, okay, this is more flexible because some projects were already using WebHDFS. We need to switch to Nox. So this thing we did with Hive, yeah, we just could throw it away like 2 months later. And then I think the most important step in securing up your Hadoop cluster is introducing Kerberos. Up to now, we just had these two proof of concepts that Matthias has just introduced with a very small group of developers and analysts and accessing the cluster. So we set up certain rules, yeah, please don't look into each other data. And that works for two projects and a small group, but of course, it doesn't work for enterprise solution, multi-tenant platform. So that was our biggest step. Introducing Kerberos. Then we found out with the ACLs, I have to admit we probably overdid a couple of things. The ACLs we said were not consistent for all the projects, became very complicated. ACLs introduced also performance overhead on the name node. The cluster, as you remember, was not sized that big. So we had already some performance issues, and we decided to switch back to using just the file attributes for security and using a more simplified security model. The next step, finally, was to move the cluster from this office network into a dedicated network zone. You will see our final architecture later, then this will make more sense to you what it means. But apparently, this also means we don't need this IP tables configurations anymore. And actually, this is where we stand today. And we went live with the configuration cyclist last year on our productional cluster with the first three applications on the cluster. But of course, we are not there where we want to go. There are still some more steps we would like to do. For instance, we would like to introduce Ranger. We are not using it yet. First, for simplifying all this access control, but also for auditing. And yeah, my biggest dream is to have a unified user management with some LDAP, but doing this in an enterprise, in a big corporate environment, is a little bit difficult. Because if you install Hadoop, it's quite convenient if you have very full access to the KDC for Kerberizing the cluster so that you can generate all the key tabs, distribute them to the nodes. I don't want to do that myself. But if you go into a big, really enterprise LDAP solution like our Active Directory, you have very strict naming conventions. You don't give away access to technical users freely. So this is still a bit of a challenge, but we are working on it. Yeah, and I've picked one point out that this is missing LDAP integration, and it's definitely an anti-pattern you should try to avoid when you build up a platform yourself. And why is it? If a user wants to use a platform, he has to usually log into the Edge node using SSH. As we have local users, the user has a dedicated password there. Then, as the cluster is Kerberized, of course, you need the Kerberos ticket before doing something with the cluster, so you have to do a knit. Authenticating versus KDC. Then finally, you can use HDFS YARN or whatever you want to do with the cluster, Spark, or whatsoever. On the other hand, at the moment already, when you come as a BI user using a JDBC connection, you connect via Nox. And Nox is already connected to the Active Directory of our company. So there you use your normal user and your normal login. At least we kept the usernames consistent, yeah? So the user don't have different usernames. We use a username from the Active Directory all over, but still it's a third password. And then, okay, just one step, and then you can access the cluster. Okay, this is for how the users access the cluster. But the big question, of course, is when you set up a platform for the POCs, you ingest some data more or less manually, you bring in some flat files and do this on a regular basis. But when you really want to deploy productive applications, you have to think about data ingestion. And the use cases Matthias has already presented, they brought new requirements for ingesting data on contrary to our existing data warehouse solutions. And what are these requirements? Well, the biggest requirement is probably that we have, in addition to batch data, that we have streaming data. This was new for us, and this data should be ingested easily into HDFS for further analytics. Then we wanted to have some decoupling of the source systems that provide the data and the analytical jobs on the back ends. This has some security requirements in it, but also some organizational requirements, because operational systems are run by other teams and other departments than the departments that do the analytics. And so we need some interface there. So some loose coupling would be great. Actually, we didn't put that much effort in our cluster in terms of operation to make it available 24/7. We just don't have the use cases for it. But if you get streaming data for ingestion, you have to make sure that the data that comes in is stored and that you don't lose it when your system or one server even only crashes. So this ingestion solution also should do some buffering and should be highly available. That means 24/7. And then, of course, security requirements. We'll see this more when I show you the network architecture. The source systems were not allowed to connect directly to the data zone where the Duplus and the data warehouse is. Of course, we need authentication and encryption. And the protocol that is used for data transfer must be audible. And yeah, one of our projects uses a data source that is not in the on-premise data center at Audi, but in the cloud. And this is also, yeah, from a security point of view, some challenge. And of course, this has to be scalable. So the project with the time, the amount of data will grow, but also the number of projects that use our platform, they grow, which is a good thing after all. That's why we built the platform in the first place. So how do we do that? Here you see our network architecture. So we have on the right-hand side, we have our data zone. In the middle, we have our messaging zone. And then we have all the sources networkers on the left. And we used Kafka cluster for data ingestion. Actually, it's a Confluent platform. It's also a Kerberized platform, so that we have authentication, which was a requirement, and we can use access control lists on the topics, so that each user or project can only access the data he is entitled to see. In addition, we used the schema registry, which is an addition to the Kafka. Kafka is just you put some bytes in and you get some bytes out. This is great in terms of flexibility. You can put everything in. But of course, when you get the data out, you must know how you have to read the data, how to interpret the data. And that's where the schema registry is in, which can be used to define a kind of interface and the schema. And so that's both the producer that puts the data in and the consumer that reads the data. They agree how the data will look like, and we can make sure that the application will continue to work. So the data's pushing their data. Not all of them are using the schema registry, depending on the project. And how does the data come from the Hadoop, Kafka cluster into Hadoop? We use two technologies there. The first thing is the HDFS connector from Confluent. That's actually used by all projects. Just connects to the Kafka cluster, gets the data, writes it to HDFS. This can automatically create or Hive tables, add additional partitionings to the Hive tables, etc. That works quite well for us. And the second technology we use less for data ingestion, but more ready for the first streaming use cases, is Spark Streaming. Of course, we had some pain points when we introduced this. And the first pain point was that we thought, OK, Kafka is really a nice interface for us to the outside world. And outside world, I still mean the Audi world. But these Kafka brokers, they only speak a binary protocol. And usually communication between all the different networks at Audi is preferred to be HTTP, so that you can have some web application firewall monitoring the traffic and making sure nothing evil gets through. That's a little bit difficult with Kafka, but still the protocol is fully specified and open, and so we could convince everyone that this is a good idea. And by now we're using it. The second pain point we're having with the schema registry, we don't have any authentication. Sorry? Okay. If you have any question, you can do it right away or at the end. With the schema registry, so everyone that can connect to the port can update the schema. This is not very good, but still it's not a big security issue because you cannot access any data. You just can update and read the metadata of the schema. And hopefully there will be a solution for that with the next releases. And the last point we just discovered very recently is with HDFS connectors that runs on the edge nodes of our Hadoop appliance. And I will dive into that a little bit, what that means. I know who's using the, some Confluent HDFS connectors already? Yeah, at least three people. That's great. So that's basically a Java process. You start it, and then you just configure using some JSON files via REST API, what's the topic in Kafka where you want to read the data from, and where do you want to store the data in HDFS. And of course, you give the security credentials. So what is my Kerberos principle to connect to the Kafka cluster, and what is my Kerberos principle to connect to the Hadoop cluster. And so this Java process, Jan runs as user Bob, and here you have his configuration. So it's reading the data from Kafka and writing it into his HDFS folder. Works as designed. Still the issue is, if you have a second user, as this port has no authentication at all, and we have many users on our edge nodes because they also use it to run Spark Shell, to start some jobs, or whatever they do there, they could easily submit their own sync configuration. And what would that mean? For example, you could deploy a file sync, and then Eve would get Bob's data. So project A can get the data from project B. So our solution to that would be to isolate all these connectors on, on special edge nodes. But yeah, we don't have that many edge nodes available at the moment. So that's still an issue for us. You also can do it the other way around, but you always have one side of the connector must always be Kafka. So you could only use it to read Bob's data in HDFS and write it to a topic where Bob can write it. Yeah, that's not a very likely scenario, but still potential issue. Okay, so now I've given you some brief ideas about the history, what we did in the past. So how does our architecture look like at the moment? This part of the picture should already look a little bit familiar to you. We have the Kafka cluster in the middle for ingesting the data using HDFS connectors or Spark streaming to Hadoop. We also have a data warehouse that had been around for quite some time already, of course. So we still, of course, have many, many systems that deliver data to the, into the data warehouse. And then we have this new architecture where systems push the data into Kafka and then to HDFS or deliver flat files directly into HDFS. Currently, we have two different kind of classes of use cases. This is, for instance, the SCAR data Matthias has told about. The data comes via Kafka, is stored in HDFS, and it's mainly used for analytics. So the analytic, the data scientists as Audi use the Hadoop cluster, they use Spark to analyze the data. But there are other projects like for Quality, for instance, who deliver the data per flat file into Hadoop and use Hadoop just as a kind of staging and pre-processing layer. So they get a lot of XML files, they parse the data there, crunch it, aggregate it, and then integrate it into the data warehouse where they need it, where they have other dimensional data, other master data, and they want to combine the data in the data warehouse and use it for reporting. That's the look how the data gets into the cluster. how does the user access the cluster? As I've said, we already have moves in this data zone, so it's not possible to access the cluster directly from your laptop. You have different options. We have a couple of BI tools and reporting tools you can access in the application zone. You can use these tools to connect to Hive and have a look at the data in HDFS, or of course in the data warehouse. Or you can connect using a Room Remote desktop, and you still can SSH into the Edge node, because we still don't have a web notebook like Zeppelin or JupyterHub. We're working on that, will be available soon. But many analysts still log in onto the Edge node and use the Spark console to do the analytics. For the developers, it will build applications that mainly Spark jobs that will be submitted to the cluster. They usually do the development on their laptop, then push the data. We have a local deployment pipeline. They push it in a Bitbucket repository. Data gets compiled and then pushed to the cluster and then executed. Yeah, and now I hand over again.
Okay. And as Carsten mentioned, the number of projects is increasing that want to use our shared service, the Kafka service, as well as the Hadoop service we provide for the group. We have a few use cases in a productive state, and just to give you a feeling about what size we talk, we have this productive Kafka cluster with 4 nodes and 128 gigabytes of RAM, 16 terabytes of raw capacity, and we have this productive Hadoop cluster with around about 1 petabyte of storage capacity, 288 cores, and 12 consisting out of 12 nodes and 6 terabytes of RAM, which is, I guess, not that huge, but quite impressive. Yeah. Okay, we also had to think about some organizational tasks that had influence on our projects and how to build up that big data service. And as one thing, we collect data out of the car. I guess the car is one of the best equipped devices out there. We're having more than 25,000 signals available. So we can't collect all those data and send it out over the air. And also, a lot of business departments are really keen on gaining insights out of that data. So we had to rethink data ownership and data governance to define a data domain model with clear responsibility in each domain. And as we provide each shared service as a multi-tenant environment, of course, we need a lifecycle management for each service in strong collaboration with the projects that use this service for the business value. And of course, we need defined SLAs. We talked about 24/7 high availability for the ingesting pipeline. We have different development life cycles between the car and the backend system. That's important because we also have a very long life cycle of each car. So we have to support them for 10 years and longer with various software versions that are built in. A big topic was the use of open source software, and not only the use of open source software, more the support for the requirements from our IT continuity department, because if you look at the long life cycle we need to support, we have to be aware of which product do we use and how can we ensure life cycle over the whole time frame. And the balance between providing a multi-tenant environment, a shared service for the whole group, versus flexibility and speed of development. So this is always a kind of balance where we say, okay, we're not the only big data platform within Audi. We have one other big initiative that only matters about stream data processing and providing swarm functions in a near real-time environment. So last but not least, we haven't talked about cloud so far, because this is the missing piece in our presentation. Because everything we presented is today is built on-premise or in our private cloud. So this is somehow the same picture as we've seen. We have this remote desktop gateway or a web gateway for the business user. From there, they can access the application zones, and only from these application zones, they can access these data zones. But as I said, cars are sold and they drive worldwide. And due to data gravity and also legal requirements, we need to get closer to the cars and where the data occurs. So we set up this second initiative where this data is first landed in a cloud environment. And to have a hybrid approach, we decided to use a direct cloud connect to ingest data still to our on-premise world, because some of the business processes are on-premise. They are in our headquarters. Yeah. But this is not the only way. Yeah. Some of the data, or most of the data, will stay in the cloud. So we also have an ingester, and we build a second cluster within the public cloud. And also, these two clusters are connected over this direct connect to share data between those two clusters. And also, the user access runs over this direct connect to share information, or had to be able to analyze both data stores on-premise and in the cloud. And last but not least, we set up a data inventory, which also is placed in the cloud, to have a some kind of metadata catalog to see, okay, where is which data located, how is this data to be interpreted, things like that. So this was the last slide. For your information, still digitalization, still a lot to do at Audi. Yeah? So we're hiring, and if you're interested in, you'll find the information on our homepage. So I hope we met some of your expectations. And if you have questions, I guess we still have some minutes for that.
Hey, great session, guys. Interested to understand, what was your experience going through the learning process, you know, bringing staff up, moving from the sort of the legacy world of the EDW into this kind of big data space? What were some of the things that you did to try and get your staff engaged and up into this level?
Yeah, that's definitely something that takes some time. What we used mainly was two things. First is online courses to give the users a basic understanding of the technologies. We already had one big on-site class for Scala and Spark development, because it turned out at Audi that in different areas where we work with big data technologies, everyone went for Spark and Scala, so we have some synergies here, which is also good. And last but not least, of course, we try to give some support to the users. We also support the project as a COC, the Center of Competence. When they go on the platform, we have an onboarding process where we help them to access the platform and try to bring the users together to learn from each other. But it's definitely something that takes some time, and it helps if you have some people, maybe hire them, that already have some experience with these technologies.
Okay. It was the first.
So, quick question. How do you implement that data catalog? Do you use Atlas, or do you have something specific there?
The data catalog is currently implemented for the data warehouse. It's an existing solution. It's a kind of commercial solution. It's not really a product. I think it's more like a solution. And now we are connecting to the Hadoop cluster, yeah, using Atlas. So.
Two questions. The first is you showed the cars that are sending the data. Are you using any edge computing on the car to store some of the data, then send it, or how you're sending the data?
Yeah.
Are they staging it where they are parked, or what is, how is it happening? The other thing is you showed 12 cluster nodes. Are you, I'm wondering, are you utilizing the fully CPU or the storage from those 12, or both? I just want to know how you utilize those 12 nodes in the cluster.
Okay, I can answer the first question. Yeah, we have a so-called onboard data collector, which is a own control unit with a ring buffer that buffers some signals when you are in a you have no connection, or you're So, but that's not that big. So, that's right. They stream it back as soon as they have connection.
Is that only with test vehicles or with all vehicles that you have right now?
We launched it with the new A8. So the new A8 is the first vehicle in the series that sends anonymous data back home.
The second question, yeah, I didn't forget it. How is the cluster used in terms of CPU, right? What's the question? Mainly what we learned with the first cluster already, that we have usually enough disk space, but the cluster is quite CPU and memory bound, especially during the day when all the analysts are using the cluster. So we have the batch jobs running at night, having some load, but the main load is during the day when the analysts use the cluster.
Okay, we have another question.
First, kudos for the session. It was really, really nice and see that there are not only unicorns going into the cloud and doing everything from scratch on a greenfield. But if you could go back in time when you guys started, what would you have changed from that first implementation? Like you use it the Flume and now you regret or something? Just wanted to get a little bit of wisdom from the path.
How do you know that we used Flume in one of the POCs? I didn't mention that. Yeah, I mean, the technologies are evolving in the big data field quite quickly. So, of course, you have to adapt at some point of time. Yeah, and what you didn't see on the slides, we started with Spark 1.6 and went through Spark 2.0, then to Pool 2.1. Yeah, so you always have to adapt. So, the only thing I would have changed is when you introduce a new cluster, don't put it into the big open office network, put it right away in a dedicated network zone that saves you some pains and sleepless nights. Yeah.
Okay, we have one question here in the back.
Thank you for your presentation. Could you tell a couple of words about team configuration they created all this infrastructure? I mean, how many people, what skills, and something like this? Thank you.
I think we have roughly five people working at Audi on the big data field, and also we have a team for running the cluster. That's an offshore team in India, and that was one of the benefits when we introduced this appliance, because it was not all saved us not only the time for building up the cluster from scratch, it also the supplier also offered some managed service for it, and so we use that with like two offshore people doing the air monitoring and some of the administrative jobs.
I have the sporty part.
Great, no, it's a great presentation. So I noticed the cluster is relatively small at this point in time, so I've had the luck to do a lot of clusters like this in automotive. One of the things that I've been doing is heterogeneous clusters where I'm integrating GPU technologies like P100 cards into the actual data nodes for active safety and autonomous vehicles and the data associated with that. And they tend to grow dramatically faster and bigger. So there are two things. Are you looking at augmenting your cluster with GPUs or DGX or DGX2s? And what is your retention policy for the data? Because once you start going down this pathway for active safety and autonomous vehicles, whether you get to level 5 or not, but when accidents happen, people want to look at the data to see what happened. And I've heard retention policies measured in like 30 plus years. So how are you addressing that issue?
Okay, that are many different questions. The first question is, yeah, we're looking into GPU as well. We have one project such requirements, but that project hasn't really started yet. One thing is we think about we could extend the cluster on-premise, or we can try to move these use cases in the cloud once our cloud platform is really ready and productive. That's something we haven't decided yet. Regarding autonomous driving, we've called this an enterprise big data platform, and still it is for a lot of different business departments at Audi, but it's not the only big data platform we have at Audi. We have at least one for the development department. We had a lot of discussion 2 years ago if we join forces and build one big platform with all the pre-development stuff or with all the data that is generated during production and afterwards with customers. And we decided to use two different platforms because the requirements of both use cases were just too different and we couldn't bring them together. And for sake of speed, we both started two different platforms. So this data you're referring for is still a third platform for this autonomous driving. And okay, this is still in development, yeah, so this kind of development platform. And that is not in our cluster.
A lot of the things you've learned in your cluster are applicable for that one, as far as authentication, access control.
Yeah.
We are in a deep exchange with this department that builds up that data. Other platform for this huge amount, because this is not possible over the air. We have the hard disks in the trunk, and there are terabytes of data that is produced by each drive, so this is a really huge amount of data.
I'm afraid we are running out of time, yeah. So if you have more questions, just try to grab Matthias and me after the talk. We'll be here the full 2 days, so and
thank
have a
you
nice
very
summit.
Much. Yeah.